All right, so Jonathan, I turn to you because I didn't want to show the video in its entirety because it is very difficult to watch because
sure.
this young man was shot 16 times. Mm-hmm. But you could see this young man walking down the street. He had a knife in his hand, a 3-inch blade. Mm-hmm. The officer arrived on the scene, and within 30 seconds, he fired his weapon and he hit the suspect.
Right.
In your mind, was that a justified shooting?
So, first off, what I do is I take the name of the officer, the name of the individual that was shot out of it. I remove the emotion from it, and I look at the tactics that were employed. You know, Brandon there is talking about this massive amount of what he terms unlawful shooting by Chicago police. But what I would ask is, in this situation, before I even explain this about whether it was justified or not, is Brandon, how would you have handled that situation? And what point do you think it crossed over to where he is using unlawful force?
Brandon?
So I've done some thinking about this. The standard that's being held for what is a lawful shooting is apparently whether the officer felt threatened, you know, personally. And the problem with that is that it's entirely subjective. It's beyond reproach. You can't say, no, you didn't feel threatened, because it's just sort of a feeling. So I would ask, if Laquan was walking away, as the video clearly shows, why did that officer
walking
need
away.
To
he
fire?
Just, he, so let's look at the facts of the video. He, Laquan, or I just
Sorry,
say
he
the
was
individual.
Walking, he was walking away
so
from all first, officers.
First off, we have to understand that before this officer shot him, there was already a series of events that have happened that set this in motion. What you see there is the end of these events that are going on, which he, I guess, had apparently slashed some tires of a cop car and had been breaking into vehicles.
But
hold on a second. I'm giving you the facts of how this happened. So they respond to the call. They see this individual walking down the street as they're converging on him, and he has a knife. It's clear in the video the way he's holding the knife out in a provocative manner. As he walks parallel to the officers and they're responding, he is within, I would say, because if you look at the lines on the street, within 10 feet. Now, we're taught in law enforcement within 21 feet that is a potential lethal area that this person could lunge at you. And here's the thing that people like Brandon need to understand is that just because you shoot a person doesn't mean they're going to fall. I talked to somebody last night that was in Fallujah. I know this is in Chicago, but was in Fallujah, who shot an insurgent 13 times as he charged him, and the guy didn't fall until he got right in front of him.
But Jonathan, this young man was on the ground, and there were multiple shots fired in quick succession.
The point is, even though he's on the ground, he never dropped the knife, and he continues to move. Until the knife leaves his hand, and we don't know if the officers were yelling at him to drop the knife, I have seen videos, and the reason we have these policies is because officers have been killed after they shot somebody with a knife or with a gun. You see, so we have to look at the reason that these policies exist.
Go ahead,
Brandon. To be clear, police officers did not see Laquan McDonald slashing tires or breaking into cars. All they saw was him walking down the street with a knife. And we saw that in the video.
They got the call.
Before they shot him, they did not give Laquan did not get a chance to speak to officers.
If you're approached by somebody with a knife, Brandon, and they're within 10 feet, are you going to give them a chance to talk
to
you?
He was not approaching them. He was walking
away from them.
You see that in the video? Did you see the video, sir?
He was walking parallel. I see the video. He's walking parallel. It doesn't matter if he walked past him. If he's within 10 feet, he can turn and lunge and take your life.
Okay, well, let's ponder about how we move forward for this, because I'm certain the city of Chicago, I mean, this police officer has been charged with first degree murder.
Sure.
Prosecutors evidently think there's enough evidence to bring him to trial for this very serious mm-hmm. charge, right? So that's going to go through the judicial process. But it doesn't negate what Brandon has brought up, that Chicago has a police with excessive force, and there's a problem in the community right at the moment. So, Jonathan, how does the city get past that and appease the community?
So what I suggest, and I didn't come on here to debate Brandon necessarily, but what I would hope is that Brandon, in his investigations, when he's going through and trying to change this relationship, is that you carefully pick out things, these shootings, if there's so many of them, you pick out ones to go after where they're clearly in the wrong. In this case, tactically, I don't think that he's in the wrong, because the policies say if an individual is armed and will not drop that lethal weapon, they can use lethal force.
The police commissioner says this police officer was in the wrong, but of course he hasn't been through the judicial process. But let's consider this before we go, because this officer in question does not have the greatest past, right?
Sure.
There have been 17 previous complaints against this officer. Allegations include excessive force, improper use of his weapon. He's also been accused of making racial remarks, and you have to wonder why this police officer was still on the force.
And that comes down to management. Management should be looking at these, and this is where Brandon, I think, that could seriously go after this. If you look at records and people have continuous uses of excessive force, why are they not being pulled in and retrained or fired? There's plenty of people who want to be cops. But in this particular instance, I see tactics that were used that eliminated the threat. That's what we're taught. So I think there's a lot of other cases that Brandon and individuals could go after. I don't think this is one of those.
Okay, well, I guess Brandon and Jonathan will have to agree to disagree. And of course, this will go through the judicial process, and we'll see what happens.
You got it.
Jonathan Gilliam, Brandon Smith, thanks to both of you for being with me.